Hey everybody, welcome back from your meal. We're glad you're still with us for ASP.NET Identity.
That's right. Welcome back from lunch. We're having a great time here in the studio. Were we not muted? You always wonder as you're talking and laughing, you're like, are we being broadcast live right now?
Is this live? I hope not.
So today we're going to be talking in this module about two-factor authentication.
And then four-factor. No, that's not even a thing. It's not even a thing.
It's probably going to be in our lifetime.
Yeah,
sometime,
that's true.
Or we'll come up with a better way.
It'll be something you know, something you are, something you remember.
First significant other. Okay, so let's talk about two-factor authentication here, shall we? Module overview. We're going to be running what is two-factor authentication, basic features of two-factor authentication, and how it works, and then we're going to look at actually how to use it. It's really easy to integrate and implement in our ASP.NET identity templates that are there. What, I ask you, good sir, what is two-factor authentication?
It's one more than one-factor authentication, that's for sure.
It's not just using, so let's start with what it's not first.
Okay, all right.
It's not using just a login and password. Even though it sounds like, well, login is one, password is two, that's not two-factor authentication. That's single factor. We need some other method to authenticate users. So it's a separate verification method or identification method. That's why I've got the icon here. You know, I want to explain those again. These ones are a little bit more understandable than maybe the Superman looking one we had earlier. So two-factor authentication, think about you log into a website and then you have the ability to use your cell phone to get a code, a text message on your cell phone, and then you go back and enter that code in a website. So real life examples, we see this all over the place. You go to the gas station and you swipe your card in there, credit card, and then they ask you for the zip. At least we do that in the States. I don't know how it is overseas. I know sometimes the credit cards work a little better overseas.
You tap it.
You tap it. It's got a chip in it. It's smart. It works like it should. Username, password, and something else. You'll see some banks do have an image. So you log into the website, and then it shows you, you know, a picture of a monkey and orange and something else and your image that only you are supposed to know that you've selected. Email security codes. We've got one of my prior jobs, we use these right here, the RSA secure IDs. So we would log into Windows, and then we would have to enter in a token from this little guy there. So make sure that if somebody stole our credentials, that we were able to, they didn't have our token, so they couldn't log in as us. So it gives a little bit extra security, and a lot of sites are using it nowadays because they want to protect their users. You don't want your application to be the one that somebody hacks, and all those credentials are dumped over the net, and people are logging into accounts, getting users' data. Imagine if you had a financial application, and somebody was able to get in and get your credentials. Well, they go over to a web browser, and they try to log in as that person, won't work, because they don't have the information required for that second factor.
So, for instance, I could actually give everybody right now my Microsoft account username and password. I won't. But if I did, you probably wouldn't be able to do anything with it. Because if you went to Microsoft.com, or not Microsoft.com, but if you went to a service like my OneDrive or my Outlook or something like that, and you tried to log in with those credentials, it would say, what? You're going to have to have, you're going to have to generate this code and put it in here. So fundamentally what we're talking about is something you know and something you have. And those are the two different factors. So the password that we've been relying on using single factor authentication, that's something that you know, right?
Yes.
And other people don't know what your password is. That's what we're relying on. Two-factor is relying on the second thing. It's something you have. So your credit card at the gas pump, you have the card, and you know a code.
Yep.
So that's two-factor.
So if somebody is able to steal your card numbers, like they've done to me two or three times already, they install little readers in different areas. I've heard some, even in some of the bank ATMs, they'll have little cameras underneath because the technology is so small nowadays, and you swipe a card in, and it'll read the numbers off of there. So if somebody gets your credit card numbers, for example, they write it out to a card. Somebody actually, one case, took my credit card number they got from somewhere, and they wrote it out to a blank credit card, and then they went to a store and swiped it. So had that store actually had another factor of authentication, they wouldn't have gone through. Thankfully, my bank caught it, and they called me. But that's one of the things that we try to prevent, that if somebody takes one piece of information, they need another to act as you. And you see a lot of the major services are using that nowadays.
Do you remember the third? Something you have, something you know.
And your DNA.
Something you are, yeah. That's where the bio comes in.
All right, so why use it? Help protect your users, as we discussed. And it's an extra piece of information that the attacker might not, hopefully, they don't have in possession. I'm sure it's happened before. Somebody's probably stolen a phone and credentials. You never know. Here's a awesome website by a good fellow I know, Troy Hunt. HaveIBeenPwned.com. So let's first off talk about something that's you don't want to happen. You don't want your application to be one on the internet that somebody happens to hack somehow, and they take all your credentials and they dump them out to the outside world to see. So what this website does, HaveIBeenPwned.com, is it looks at some of the major leaks that have happened through some major providers out there. And Troy's basically taken all that data, all those email accounts, brought it into a database that you can access through the website. You type in your email address there, and it will tell you if your email address was involved in any of those leaks out there. So it's very good. If you happen to share credentials across websites, then you know that you better go change them on all of your other websites to something different for each site, of course. But it's a great site to check out. So even if you have credentials that are have been leaked in one of these locations, ideally, if those people use two-factor authentication, it wouldn't matter because somebody wouldn't be able to log in anyway, but a lot of those folks don't use it. It is on the rise, though. You see a lot of all the major providers now are using it. So just kind of a word of caution here. Be wary of email as a second factor. Why? Because if you are logging in with an email as your user ID and a password, and then your second factor goes to that email address, well, what if somebody already has your email and password, and that's the same email password to your email account? All right, well, they just log into your email, get the code, go back to the website, enter it in, and they're in as you.
And it really doesn't qualify as two-factor anyway, because it's relying on two things that you know, and that's not valid. It needs to be something you know and then something physically that you have. You know, the code I get on my phone is relying on the fact that I have the phone with the SIM card in it in my possession. So now it's something I have.
Yeah, and I mean, I would say better than nothing, better than just a login and password.
Yeah.
I would still recommend, if your only choice is to do email, by all means do it. Just be aware there are way better ways of doing it than just by email for those very reasons. Okay, Microsoft, Google, Facebook, Apple, and a whole lot more all support it now. So all those providers, you can go into your account and configure two-factor authentication. And so now we're going to show you today how you can actually do this in your application. So let's talk about some basic features in a two-factor system. User registers for a system, and then at some point in the future, or during registration, they give that second factor of information. So usually it's an opt-in process as it stands now. A lot of systems you go to and say, you know what, my Gmail account, for example, or my Microsoft account, I want to use two-factor authentication for this. It's not your default login procedure. You have to go in and enable it. Go to the providers, log in, and then you add your phone number, and then boom, it just works. So at some point in time in the future, you opt in and you provide it. There are some systems out there that do require it up front, and if you want to use that for your enterprise, you're more than welcome to. Very easy to configure that, as we'll see here. And then every future new login requires it, depending on how you develop your application. But the idea is that if I do two-factor on my system, I get my code, I'm good for that session. If my browser remembers me, all right, I'm still good on my computer. If I go to a new computer and log in, doesn't recognize me there, then I have to go through the whole two-factor process again. And that's good, because every single time I log into something, I don't necessarily want to get something on my phone. I just want to work. But when I go to a new system, I want to know that I'm protected like that. So the out-of-box support here in ASP.NET Identity, all the templates have all the boilerplate code that you need. And we're going to run through that. So it makes it very easy for you to implement, and we'll see how we can do that. All of the notification procedures here revolve around an interface, iIdentity Message Service. It's real simple. It has one method on there, send async. So this class gets notified. You register your provider saying, hey, I'm a SMS service, or I'm an email service, or your own custom service. And then when the time comes to get notified, that method gets called, and you do whatever you want with it. You either send off an SMS with the code. That message property there, identity message, right here, this actually contains the code in it and a potential message to send to the user. Out of the box, SMS and email stubs are in place. You can do your own custom providers, though. And you must complete the implementations. In other words, by default, it's not active. You have to go in and make a couple code changes. It's not a big deal. It's pretty easy, and we'll go through that in a template here. How, I ask you, how does it work? Well, there's a magic formula here. So one thing is to note, and this is, we're going to talk about this a little bit more in the last module too, about security stamp. You have a security stamp that exists in the database for your user account, and it's a GUID in there, just this unique identifier, and anytime that important information in your account changes, that security stamp updates. So with that in mind, what happens is the user logs in. Let me show you, I actually have a browser loaded up. We'll get to that in one second here. You are seeded with a security stamp, this GUID, and there's an algorithm, TOTP. So let me switch over here real quick. Time-based one-time password algorithm. So your security code that is in the database, that GUID, is used as a seed for this algorithm. So it's unique to you. And remember, anytime you change your own information, that GUID in the database changes. And this time-based one-time password algorithm uses the time and that GUID, that unique ID, to generate a code. And that code is good for 90 seconds. So when you get notified of that code in your email or through a text message, you have 90 seconds to come back and enter in and verify it. And it's going to look at your security stamp and verify the code that you've entered. And then, as long as that gets verified out, the SMS service, when you generate that token, I should say this, back up one second here, when that token gets generated, that security stamp gets generated, that in turn notifies your SMS service, your email service, whatever that interface, any of those providers that you register in startup for your application, and we'll look at those registrations, any of those providers you register with iIdentity Message Service, it will call into them. You could have 10 different providers. Then, since we've already logged in, a cookie's written out to let us know that, hey, this user is already logged in. We don't have to make them log in when they enter their code again. Otherwise, you'd have to log in, enter code, log in, enter code over and over. So the verification process now, so that was just the kind of submission process, right? That takes the code, that sends it out. Verification, user enters a token, so they take their phone, let's say we're using SMS, enters a token. The same process happens essentially in reverse here. That TOTP token is validated, and that's checked against the security stamp that is for your user account in the database and the time. And remember, that's 90 seconds you have. Access is then granted or denied if it's out of time range or it's not the right code, of course. So can you extend it? Out of the box, we have SMS and we have email. And you can absolutely extend it. You can extend virtually any part of the identity system. Everything is interface driven. So that means that you can essentially implement the interface and insert your own classes almost wherever that you want. So in this case, if you want your own token provider, no problem. You can use your own iUser token provider. There's just a few methods you need on there, four methods we can see there. And then you need some sort of custom notification service if you want that. And that's just iIdentity message service with a single method, send async, and that just sends out the message for you. Very easy to extend. Couple helpful hints. So when I'm going through the templates and I first learn ASP.NET Identity running through, some things kind of catch you up, right? This happens to everybody. So just a couple little helpful hints I want to share with you as you're going through and you're developing. I want you to remember that you won't be verified by default. So you go into the application, you're going to have to add the phone number, and that's going to trigger the verification. If you don't have a phone number on hand, you haven't stored a phone number in your profile, then those SMS functions in that class, your SMS service, they're never going to be called. So you need to add the phone number, and then when you do it, it'll be notified out through your SMS service. And we're going to look at this. We're going to debug through this. Also, debug, set breakpoints, step through the process. I've seen various times when I'm testing this out, maybe I forgot something. I might not have all the code I need, or I don't have something uncommented that's there in the templates. So debug. It's real easy to kind of figure out where things are going wrong because it's just a few steps to enable it. And email will only be available as a second factor if it's a verified email. So somebody just can't throw it in. It's got to be a verified email in order for it to appear. All right, let's look at a demo of using two-factor authentication, shall we? Okay, I've created a basic web project here, same thing we've done before. And I've just called this one basic two-factor. So there's nothing different about this one. Let's run this. And I will register here. Just like we've done like 100 times so far today.
We are well authenticated in this sample ASP.NET application.
All right, everything right now is the default template. This hasn't been modified at all. Let's go back here. We've got our default connection, our database. Let's open up my user table and show table data in there. All right. There's my email in the database. Has my email been confirmed? So we can do, there's built-in email confirmation. And you can see my phone number is null. There's a security stamp. Notice that's just a GUID. The hash password. Has my phone number been confirmed? Well, what's that all about? When you go ahead and enable this, you're going to get a text message that's sent out to your phone. Well, let me rephrase that. Ideally, when this is implemented, you will have a text message that goes out to your phone. All that boilerplate code isn't there. You're going to have to fill in whoever your SMS provider is, and I'll show you actually a sample of that. Once that code is confirmed, that becomes true. So you know if the user has actually confirmed it. You don't want to use it for two-factor auth if the user has not confirmed it. Because imagine somebody hacks an account and then sets up their own phone number as a two-factor. Maybe they don't have the login. They've sat down at your computer while you're away. So there's some difficulties there. You always want to make sure that phone number is confirmed. Has this user enabled two-factor authentication? Well, currently it's false, and we'll see how we change that. And the rest of these fields, we'll actually look at some of those later on today. So pretty easy so far with that. Now let's look at our code. If we notice, let's run that again. The first key here is we have to look at our user account. So let me log in, because we have to enable this in our user account. Oops, not F1. Fingers going all over the keyboard here. For some reason, after lunch, my fingers have gotten like sloppy on the keyboard.
Right.
I think it's because it was a delicious lunch. Yummy. All right, now, so I'm logged in, just like we saw before, nothing new here. I click on my account up here, manage. And that goes to my manage controller here. Change your account settings. I can change my password. External logins, manage. That's if we wanted to do like Facebook, for example, just like we looked at before. Now, two-factor authentication. There are no two-factor authentication providers configured. See this article, which is a pretty cool article, for details on setting this up. But we're going to set this up right now. It doesn't seem very obvious by looking at this how we can suddenly enable this. In fact, if we go to our web application, let's stop this. Actually, I'll just detach so it stays running in the background. If we go over here and we look at our if we look at our startup code here, even if I just search for two-factor, so here we have use two-factor sign in cookie. Use two-factor remember browser check. So there's some code there that's already active. It's not commented out. And now if I look down here, this is now in our identity config class. So our identity config is underneath app_start. Remember, we start up and we configure our OWIN components, and we configure our identity components. So this is under identity here. And we have our register two-factor provider. So we're calling into the manager. This is the same class that we set our password validator on, all this stuff down the line. This is our application user manager. We're registering a two-factor provider. So it's called email code, and the other one is called phone code. We're giving it the class here, phone number token provider. Your security code is And then we have this one here, another registered two-factor provider, an email token provider. So to generate the tokens for you, the security tokens. And we can see the message, how it comes out here. Your security code is, and here security code is. You can customize these. Built in, there are two properties, manager.emailService and manager.smsService. So if we go and we look in those, in Microsoft.asp.net, identity.usermanager, we have SMS service, and the email one is in here too. So this sets two services up for notification. Let's go here to the definition of that class. This is the iIdentity message service. Super, super simple. That interface has one method. In other words, any class that implements this interface has one method it has to do, and this is where it's going to send the message out to the users. So email service uses implements iIdentity message service, and SMS service implements the iIdentity message service interface as well. Both of them with the one method here, send async. So let's set some breakpoints here. As of now, nothing's going to be called, because remember, we have this code here that says, hey, you don't have anything configured. And it looks interesting because so far I'm like, well, if I looked at my classes here, it kind of looked like I have everything configured. I specified that there. I've specified this there. This should be okay. You have to do a little bit more looking in here. And if we look over at this guy right here. So we are in our index.cshtml. So under manage index.cshtml. So in other words, when a user is logged in and they go to /manage, that will bring them to the manage controller. And by default, it goes to the index method here. And we've got a couple of messages that get formed here. The view model, two-factor. Notice, it's calling in get two-factor enabled. So this is checking to see if two-factor happens to be enabled for this user, which it's not right now. We saw that in the database when we looked at it. So the code that we need to change is just simply in our view that's getting returned here. So that's our manage controller, points to our manage folder here, our index.cshtml, and let's look through this code. So here's a change your password link. If we look over here, change your password, there's our external logins. So this is the code file that we want. And notice there's a bunch of stuff commented out here. Phone numbers can be used as a second factor of verification in a two-factor authentication system. And here, uncomment the following block. After you have set up two-factor authentication, well, what does it really mean to set up two-factor authentication? What it means in the context of this is we have to integrate. We have stub code that gets called right now. That send async method will get notified. We need to do something with that. We need to send an email out or send a text message out. In this case, we want to send a text message out. So they're saying, hey, before you do this, you want to make sure this text message is going out and a user has a way to get that code. Because right now, we're just going to call that send async method and it doesn't do anything. So you need to finish off that implementation. So let's look at this. I'm going to uncomment this out like my code says here. Uncomment it. So we'll just uncomment that. Save that. And that looks like it's allowing us to set our phone number. That's all that part does. If I come over here and I refresh this page, there we go. Now I have the option to add a phone number. Let's go back to our code though and see what else we have. So phone number, and down here, two-factor authentication. There are no two-factor authentication providers configured. Notice, there's nothing that's actually looking at any code. It's just text that says that. That's not actually detecting anything. It's a little bit misleading. It says there's none configured. Well, that just means you haven't uncommented this code here. So we're going to comment that out. And we're going to uncomment this here. Control K U.
You can say whatever you want if you just edit the HTML.
That's right. Like that, right? Therefore, it's true.
Yep.
So now down here, this gets a little bit smarter about it. Recall that in our managed controller, We have this field that's being sent back to our view. Is two-factor enabled for this user? And that's going to be true or false. If we look at the actual code here, and this is basically saying, hey, if two-factor is enabled, we're going to show them that it's enabled. We're going to give them a link to disable it. Otherwise, it's disabled, and we're going to give them a link to enable it. So that looks good so far. Save that, and we're going to refresh our view here. Perfect. Looks now, it's partially configured. All we did was uncomment. We've done nothing else so far at all, except uncomment some code in that index.cshtml. So let's go ahead and set up some breakpoints here in our let me close some of these extra windows out here. So we're going to go to our SMS service. And notice I've got a breakpoint here in our send async and our email service on send async. So let's just create just a fake user account and see what happens so far as of this point. I'm going to create a new user account. Register. I'm going to go and manage. This is slash manage. Okay, let's enable. Still, nothing's happened yet. So I'm going to change my password. I'm sorry, not change my password. I'm going to add a phone number. And a phone number, let's do now notice, as soon as I clicked on submit, it's calling in here to verify. So my SMS service with that one single method has gotten notified. This is where you would call out to your SMS provider, and I'll show you an example of that as well. But let's look at what this message contains. That kind of fades off. It's a little bit hard to see these with zoom in here. So your security code, there's my security code, 754732. There's my destination phone number I should be sending it to. I'm going to copy out the security code because I'm going to need that. And hopefully we do this inside of 90 seconds. Submit, your phone number is added. So that's adam@no.com. Let's go ahead and log off. There we go. Just like that, select your two-factor authentication provider. Notice we only have a phone because we haven't done anything with email here. Submit. Same exact thing. We are now going back out, and this is calling. This is sending a test message out to this phone number with a new code now. Destination. Let's run it. Pretend that I just got a text message on my phone. Paste it in right there. Option to remember this browser so I don't have to do this every single time. And then we submit. That's it. So just like that, we've implemented a two-factor authentication. So again, the steps here, all we did, we went into our index.cshtml, we uncommented our code. And the second required step was that we went to our manage, we added the phone number, we enabled two-factor authentication for this user, just for that user. So if we go back and we look at the database here, in our ASP.NET users table, there we go. This is the account I was using, adam@no.com. There's my phone number. Has my phone number been confirmed? Yes, it has. That's the first step that we got. Is two-factor enabled? Yes, it is. Simple as that. So let's take this demo a slight bit further because let's do something that we will probably do in reality here. And let's take... We're going to install a NuGet package here. Install dash package, not pancake. Twilio. Twilio is an SMS provider. I've seen them in a lot of hackathons, so I'm going to use this one right here. So it installed the client libraries for me here. Let's go back to our SMS service. And right here, we need to finish this off. Implementation is key, because as of right now, this is empty. That's why everything's disabled by default, because you don't want to send, well, you don't want to pretend you're sending a text message out and your actual application is now waiting for a response, but then the user never got anything. That's why everything's disabled and you need to fill this in first. So I've got open. Some template code here. All right. So I pasted some code in here. There's a Twilio REST client. I'm going to resolve that reference here and resolve this reference just to bring in those namespaces. And I don't care about my trace actually right now. So all we're doing is we're getting some credentials that prior to this demo, I just put in my web config. So I won't show you those, but if you register on Twilio's site, you will get same thing like we saw for Facebook. There's a SID and a token you have to enter in. So that I've already got those configured in my web config. Secondly, I have Twilio gives you a phone number. And so it's going to be sent from this phone number. And that should go out and send to that particular user. So who wants to share their phone number? That is the trick here. I know what we'll do. Yes, thank you. Keep on me for a moment here. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to update my own personal phone number in here.
You want me to read that out loud?
555 Jeremy Foster. All right, I think I've got this here. All right, let's go ahead and run it and let's see what happens. I know it's going to be hard for you to see my phone here. I'm going to turn up my volume. Maybe we'll hear a noise come in. All right, I'm going to run this. And let's go ahead and log in. Keep our fingers crossed. I don't know if I have the sound enabled
on. Is your screen safe to show now?
My screen safe. Safe to show. Safe to show. All right, I'm going to log in. Choose my awesome account here, adam@no.com. Okay, two-factor code. Let me see, do I have those breakpoints set there? This is just running, no breakpoints. So we'll submit. Okay. There we go. Camera on me.
Ah, I see that.
Come across the top there, right there. All right. Sent from your Twilio trial account. Your security code is 909er rhubarb foxtrot. Now 517234. Look at that. Just like that.
Boom.
Super, super duper, duper duper easy. You just change what's implemented here in the send async method. You send out to your provider of choice. And again, you can plug in your own here. You can customize this however you want. Pretty easy.
Yeah, yeah.
It's awesome. This is
you can use Twilio. You can send a pigeon. I think you can do Morse code. There's all kinds of ways you can send verification codes.
There is, there's a link on the net I saw that actually customizes this to use, I think Google's kind of QR code system there to validate it.
Well, so somebody in the chat room actually pointed out the Google Authenticator app and how you can integrate with this to the Google Authenticator app and actually have your code showing up in the one app.
And I think that might even be the one I was thinking of. Google Authenticator, ASP.NET.
Why don't you go ahead and switch to my screen and you can have a glance at it. I've got it pulled up right now. There
this
you
is
go.
The Be a Big Rockstar site.
This one?
No,
this is
I got
a code project.
This one over here.
Let's switch to yours.
Wait, I'm sure that's good too. Let's see that one.
Yeah, so this is the one that was pointed out on the chat room. And so this is instructions for how to integrate with the Google Authenticator app. And you can see if I don't have Zoom in, let me get this in, turned on here. No, I don't have it on here, but I'll use another means. Look at that. Got to be resourceful. You can see that these individual individual email addresses are showing up in here. So you can have yours show up in their Authenticator app. You know what I want is I want authentication on my Microsoft band.
That would be pretty cool.
That would be pretty awesome. So
did you know that you can pay at Starbucks with it?
I did know that.
Found that out.
I haven't done it yet.
He said they were all kind of crowding around looking at it. I was like, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Neat. Switch over to my screen 1 second here, please. Good sir. This one, this is the other one here on beabigrockstar.com. Using Google Authenticator, right with the ASP.NET identity. So this is a cool one to check out. I have a link to this, a URL at the end of the slide deck, so I'll show you that as well. And notice this also uses a TOTP code as well.
And so the TOTP code is being generated by ASP.NET in the case that you showed and just texted via Twilio, right?
Yep, correct.
But then if you use this authenticator sample that we're talking about, then the TOTP is actually being generated by the authenticator app.
The TOTP in that case is being authenticated.
It's by the authenticator app because the big advantage to it is that it doesn't have to go over the network. So if you're sitting on an airplane and you don't have can't use that. People have Wi-Fi connections on airplanes these days. If you're sitting in a submarine,
it's crazy.
And
submarine.
And I don't think you get Wi-Fi these days on submarines. So if you're sitting in a submarine and you want to generate a code, you can't do it by any sort of a like SMS or email or anything like that. So that's when the authenticator apps are really helpful because you can two-factor authenticate and log into your service.
I'm going to do a custom provider for Dolphin sonar.
There you go. There you go.
Communication protocol. All right. A couple slide references at the end here. If you are interested in learning more about TOTP, what that is I like technology, so I think it's a cool subject here. Great blog post there on understanding it. And if you really like the nitty-gritty details, I just figured I'd throw it on there. I read a little bit of it. It is actually a pretty cool read. And there's the last one there, beabigrockstar.com, and that's using Google Authenticator with ASP.NET Identity. Really cool blog post.
Just a quick note, make sure that you go and vote on the polls. There's a poll that's active and that's really cool, really helpful for us. So
I gotta ask, is it should Adam implement the Dolphin sonar?
That's probably the poll. Yeah. Yeah. Which implementation should we implement first? Dolphin sonar, Morse code, or Pigeon?
Or the zombie, there's gotta be a zombie play on this. Zombie moaner translator.
There's zombies in everything now.
Yep. All right.
All right, well, are we cool for two-factor authentication? That certainly felt thorough.
I think we're cool for it. Pretty easy to set up. Just remember, fill out your code to send out a code. Fill out the code to send out a code. That's funny. In anything that has a send async method in there, just fill out your implementation, uncomment the code, and then it's up to the user to enable. If you want this to be required as part of the login process, then you would just use the user manager to set that on the user's account when they log in the first time. So user manager has all of those fields available to you, and so you can actually just code those to true ahead of time, and that way when a user registers, they have to go through that process. It's up to you on however you want to integrate for your system, but it's real easy to change.
Well, let's go ahead and take a break, huh?
Let's do it.
We'll see you back here in 10 minutes.
See you shortly.